All right. Have you learned anything this morning?
Yes.
You have learned about some old part of man by the name Patrick Ferguson. Sorry, Rascal, sent a message over here to tell us what he's going to do to us. I'm going to talk to you about firelocks, or muzzle, which is the general term. Firelock is also another term, proper to use it as well, too. First, let me explain what a muzzle loader is. A muzzle loader is one that loads from the muzzle end. In other words, the same end that the ball comes out. Then you've got to push it all the way down to here before you can shoot it. Another term I want to give you is one called a musket. Musket really is a military type firelock made in the military use. And what qualifies it pretty much for a military type firelock? Most of the time, they are smoothbore. Sometimes they're rifles. But it's a large caliber, usually something over 50 caliber. Also, it's equipped with lug on it. You can put a bayonet on it, and you can shoot with the bayonet on, not have to take it off. Anything else that doesn't have this, if you use a bayonet at all, which is not normal, you have to have a plug and stick it in the end of the barrel, and then you cannot shoot it. Well, what are we going to talk about? Well, you know, I'll hit myself for a second. There are two types of muzzle loaders, just the same as they are today. Smoothbore and rifles. Today, your smoothbore is a shotgun. That is inside of the barrel is just as slick and smooth on the inside as it is on the outside. With that being said, when the ball comes out, it just kind of does its own thing. It sort of comes out and just bounces around through the air. It's not very accurate. You don't go truly straight from where you want it to go. 50 yards, you're kind of lucky, maybe 60, to hit something bigger than that. And you know, it's not real effective at distance, but it's very effective in close-to-close shooting. So, the one we're going to talk about today is this one here called a brown bess. We talk about two or three reasons. First is, it was used on Kings Mountain. Second is, it introduces new technology to the firelock. Because the firelocks that you had at that time, when you broke one, you had to go back to whoever made it to repair it. The British was the largest military force on earth in the 1700s. They did not have time to send these back home to get them repaired. So they wanted something that was very durable, very hard to damage, but they also wanted the parts in it to be interchangeable. So that's what this does. All the parts on here are interchangeable. The metal is very strong and durable. As you can see, it's a good sized lock. It's hard to damage something that big. The wood is English maple. You can't hardly scratch it. So it's very durable. If it gets dropped or anything, usually you pick it up and shoot it. If not, you go down and get the part for it and repair it. It's called a brown bess. Not because that's the name of it, it's a nickname. Nobody knows where it comes from. It's a nickname. Brown bess is a 75 caliber smoothbore. 75 caliber means 3/4 inch ball. That size ball right there is shot out of this thing. Now the British were trained to shoot this thing 4 times a minute. Now you'll find out when I talk about the rifle, you can't load a rifle in 4 times a minute, every 15 seconds. It just takes much longer. I'll show you the steps there in a little while. Right quick, one question. I'll get to that. Now usually I get to the question, so don't worry too much about it. So, but anyway, 75 caliber ball, they will shoot these things 4 times a minute. Well, they figured out a way to kind of cheat us. they made paper cartridges. We use cartridges today, don't we? Now the cartridge had the ball in one end, had powder here. You had to have two opposing teeth to bite it, tear the end off, put some powder in the pan, pour the rest of the powder down the barrel, drop the rest of it down, pull the ramrod off, shove it all the way down. The British shot these things with what was called volley fire. It's like you're all sitting right there, except you'd be standing, probably two, might be more rows. You'd get a command, load, fire, and everybody in that line would fire at one time. You'd drop down, second line back there, get their command, shoot, and then start all over. Now, they would advance toward the enemy a little by little, and then they had to do hand-to-hand combat. Well, when they did that, then they used this little thing out here called a bayonet. That's how you fought close in. Usually it was probably fixed when you went into battle. If not, you got commands to do it. It's military, everything is done by command, both sides. You put it up, and you start jabbing by command. Jab at your enemy until you push it back. That's how the brown vest works. A rifle works the same way, except one real, real big important difference. It has grooves in it. Anybody know why it has grooves down the barrel? Pardon? Yes, well, yes, it helps in aiming. But it helps more in once it's fired. But accuracy, that's correct. Just like when you draw back to throw a football, you want that football to do what? Come on, quick granny, you know what it is. I'm from the looks of what you're wearing, I'd say you throw at least two or three of them. You want it to spiral, don't you? And why do you want it to spiral? Because of what she says. Makes it accurate, more accurate. It gets the target quicker. It hits the target where you want it to hit. That brown vest maybe hits something 50 yards away. Probably it'd have to be bigger than that right there, 50 yards, half a football field. But you give me 2 or 3 football fields, tell me which letter you want me to hit, where you want me to hit, I'll put this ball in it. Well, I'll be back. I won't, but they could. I'm not that good, I don't shoot enough to do it. But anyway, that's how accurate it becomes. It calls it confidence. It uses a small ball, about the size of that. That's 45 caliber, slightly half less than a half inch, it's still the difference. Now then, to load these properly takes a lot longer. Roughly about a minute for those guys at that time to do it, because they were used to doing it. Now you have a lot more gear you carry. With the brown vest, you had this, you had your bayonet. Basically, that was it. Of course, about your wife carried a bag like that because she had other stuff in it. But as far as what you need, that's all you carry. Now me, as a long hunter, I would have this bag, I would have a powder hole, probably a powder razor. I've had rags, cloth, bag, put lead ball in, so forth. Probably some, see back there, a way to melt some lead, make more. In order to load one of these, what you do, and I don't have my powder razor. Yesterday when I was putting this together, I realized it wasn't in there, and I forgot to get it last night. But you would have a powder razor that had a set amount of powder. You fill it that way every time. Because you want the same amount if you want to hit that spot we were talking about. If you had less, you might not hit it. If you had more, you wasted it. So you want the exact amount. You pour it down this powder horn into the measure. Then you pour it down the barrel. Then you take the cloth. This cloth was greased, bare grease, some kind of grease. Lay it over the end of the muzzle. Take it off. Lay it on top of it like that. Short starter, tap on it until this ball is started. Take your neck knife, cut it off, have it for the next shot. Take this other end, shove it down a little bit more, pull the ramrod out and ram the ball all the way down to right here. Now the next step is to take this little horn, priming powder in it, put a little powder in the pan, close this up, and you're ready to shoot. Take your powder in. That's why we hid behind trees and rocks instead of standing out in the line like the British did. That's kind of how this particular firelock works. And I might take a couple quick questions and I'll close with a few comments. Any questions on firelocks? I don't know if any of you have ever shot any. They're a lot of fun. And gentlemen, let me ask you this question. Are you better shots than these ladies right here? You are? These ladies say no. he could. He turned shy on me. Oh, you could see the answer. He just couldn't get the words in his mouth. But you're right. Then and even today, the ladies most always outshoot. And I teach this at scout camp every year. The instructor taught me how to do this program right here years ago. I was a muzzleloader instructor, and he said that the girls usually outshoot the boys. We've seen that. And that's not to say that the boys are probably good either. But now I will tell you one quick story. Scout came 2 or 3 years ago. We were just doing a pre-shoot, and they come black powder part of it. This one girl, she just waited until right to the end, and she goes up and shoots, boom, boom. I said, shot these before. She said, oh, not that, but I am going to shoot them. All right. Any other questions? You'll find out probably a little bit more about some history relating to the Overmountain men as you go through the other stations. I know my wife's down there, she'll throw something at you about how the moms and you stayed home, had to provide for yourself, and how you would, by your age, y'all probably pretty good at these things, male or female.
Which one?
This right here is called the shooting block. Instead of going through cutting off the cloth and stuff, it has it in it. There's the ball. You lay it over. Of course, this one has its own plunger. Or you use the short starter, jab it in, and you're ready to ram it down. Shortcuts, and then different ones had different things. Some of them were good enough that they hold the palm of their hand. Pour the right amount of powder out. It may not have been 100% accurate, it was close enough. But any time I ever tried it, I couldn't get it in the barrel, so I lost the pour of the powder anyway. All righty.
Thank you, Mr. Doan.
You are welcome.